It's a global initiative to protect the earth from its many problems and challenges that it is facing. This year's edition is that celebrating the planet we're protecting. And as a school, we are participating. What we are going to look at as a school is environmental conservation. How we are going to conserve our environment, making the planet a very good place to live. I have a student to my knee who's going to join me to moderate this session. Let's put our hands together for them as they sit and prepare for. Okay, so we have Edward Kobna Tabika. Let's clap for him. We have Geoffrey Asiama. We have Ajua Frimpong. We have No Kabara. And we have Kofi Asumani. I'm assisted by Senator Akwili. Let's clap for him. Okay. I believe that at the end of this program, we will have a very, we'll see the bigger picture about the need for us to engage in environmental conservation, which is a very important. Kofi, when we say environment, what comes to your mind?
The environment is anything around us and how it influences or affects our life and society.
Please, how would you describe the natural environment?
Anything that influences the planet and its resources contributes to, we call them an environment.
Okay, let's clap for them.
It has changed the weather patterns. For example, at this time of year, it's not actually supposed to be raining, but because of climate change, it's raining more and more frequently, causing floods around the country.
And we know plants give us oxygen, and we give them carbon dioxide. With plants being extinguished, we realize that we are giving out more carbon dioxide, and there's no plants out there to taking that carbon dioxide and go through the chemical processes to produce oxygen. So our atmosphere is being composed more of carbon dioxide than oxygen, and that's affecting us humans because you're not able to take in the oxygen that we need for survival.
They produce sulfur, which reacts with water, the water vapor and oxygen in the atmosphere, which produces sulfuric acid. And when this falls down,
it
doesn't come as rain, but it comes as acid rain, which damages the plants in the environment. So we have to try as much as possible to reduce the burning of coal and oil. Yeah, thank you.
System.
Okay, by creating national parks and wilderness areas, by doing this, we boost the ecosystem because the animals are more free, and the ecosystem affects our life. If the animals are suffering, they come to the cities, and maybe you might see a lion walking around in a city because he needs food. So by creating wilderness areas and national parks, the animals get a good ecosystem to live in and a nice habitat and place to survive.
Okay, we are still on ways that we can conserve our environmental systems. Please, Ajua, is there any way that you can share with us so that we can be able to be environmentally responsible?
Some countries get involved in cleanup exercises. Some time ago, Ghana used to do a cleanup exercise the first Saturday of the month.
I think one importance of conservation of our environment is that if we destroy our environment, we destroy most of the habitats for some animals. And if we destroy habitats for most of the animals, we minimize their chance of survival, which means that we are destroying the food chains and ecosystems.
Bad things of destroying. When you cut down trees or destroy a habitat, the animals there and the plants have to move. And when they move to another habitat, the conditions there are not what they're used to. For example, like in a panther in a rainforest, and we cut down the rubber trees, they have to go and look for another home for themselves. So they go to a desert, but the desert has too much heat for them, other than the other animals that are used there. So if we cut down trees, we're not only destroying habitats for animals and the food chains, we're also destroying our food, and we're also destroying plants that we used to eat.
We need the world's greatest minds and brains to fix the planet rather than find another place to go and live. So as we are celebrating the planet worth protecting, I think it's best that we protect this planet that we have rather than think of where we want to go and live next. Thank you.
We are celebrating a planet worth protecting, right? For me, I think that we need to start this celebration in our homes. Why did I say in our homes? One of our panelists made a comment about recycling. The very things we use in our homes. If we want to protect the planet, we are all talking about the big ones. What about the little ones in our homes? Whereby we go out there, we buy things, and we even prefer the item to be put in a poly bag for us instead of paper bags. You know, with the paper bags, even if we dispose them off, in no time, give it a few days, it rots and mixes up with the soil. But with the poly bags, we all know it takes years for them, and at times they don't even decompose. So we dispose them off, they get mixed up with the soil, and we are killing the little insects, ants, and anything that lives, the animal that lives in the soil. It even impedes the growth of some of the plants, because as the roots of the plants are moving, they get impeded by these poly bags. So I would say that as we celebrate, let's not think too far, but let's look close to us, the things we use and how we dispose them off and how we handle them. And I think in these little ways, if you do it, I do it, she does it, he does it, we'll all together be protecting the earth. Thank you.
Our constructors or miners should stop cutting down trees, because they are the source of our life. Like, they give us oxygen, they give us medicine and food. So I do hope, in relation to a food chain, the plants are the producers for the herbivores, and then we eat both plants and animals. We need them to sustain. Thank you.
What we've already used, we should reuse the stuff that we know we can reuse, and we should recycle the materials that we know can be recycled. Thank you.
You take the director. So maybe we can. Okay. Thank you. So we can bring this one. Okay. So. Yes, sir. So we are preparing the place for Thank you. Yes, sir. So we are preparing the place for. You have to send the police for their laptop and everything before they come.
Deforestation can be defined as deliberate removal of forest by human activities such as commercial agriculture, industrialization, urban expansion. Then if these things happen by human, then you can see we are removing the forest and replacing with a different land use. Biodiversity, by virtue of our pictorial presentation, you can see different life forms, variety of life. That is, we have ecosystem, and within an ecosystem, let's say the forest ecosystem, we have animals, we have plants, and they interact or live together. And by virtue of their activities, they make the ecosystem complete, and the ecosystem survivor depend on each other. Some are dependent on others. That is what we can talk about. Saprophytism. We have epiphytes. We have competition among each other as being used each other for food. And we have others doing dispersion, pollination, fertilization. We have microorganisms that decompose decaying organic matter or litter. So all put together form the ecosystem for which each component plays an important role. So if you eliminate each component, the whole ecosystem is not complete. That means biodiversity is very important. So loss of biodiversity is very expensive to the survival of man. If we are talking about effort being made to reduce deforestation and ecosystem biodiversity loss, then we have to give you briefing on sector, that is the forestry sectors that are in charge of the effort that are going to be made. We talk about the Ministry of Lands and Forestry, or Ministry of Lands and Natural Resources, as it's being called now. And they are mandated to sustainably manage the utilization of our land, our forest and wildlife, as well as efficiently manage the mineral resources for socio-economic development of our nation. They also formulate policies for implementation of all the commissions under the ministry. We have the Forestry Commission, Minerals Commission, and Land Commission. The ministry formulates policy for implementation of each of the commission. We have their functions. I'll mention some few. Promote sustainable extraction and use of mineral resources. They ensure the restoration of degraded natural resources. They reduce the loss of biodiversity. Maintain and enhance protected area systems. They reverse forest and land degradation. Encourage appropriate land use management. And adapt to impact and reduce vulnerability to climate variability and change, just to mention but a few. We come to FORIG, or Forest Research Institute of Ghana. It's another institution that undertake research for sustainable utilization of our forest and forest products. And their functions are to research and disseminate the information for improvement of socioeconomic and environmental well-being of the people of Ghana. With regard to RED Plus, the acronym RED Plus, reducing emission through deforestation and forest degradation, and the plus means enhancement of carbon through conservation of our forest and sustainable development of our forest, sustainable management. So with regard to that, they are involved in the assessment, monitoring, verification of changes in vegetation and carbon stocks under the various land use models. We come to Forestry Commission, that was established by Act of Parliament 571 as a corporate entity that can be sued and be sued. Functions of Forestry Commission: regulate the utilization of the forest timber resource, manage the forest resource and protected areas, assist the private sector to implement the forest and wildlife policy, and undertake development of plantations. These are key functions of Forestry Commission. But all these institutions cannot work on their own or alone, because they need people to criticize them, they need people to advocate, other quarters to assist or support their functions. That is stakeholders. You can see multiplicity of uniform or representation. This is what we call stakeholders. They have diverse interests. Each stakeholder has his own interest according to his stake. So if I'm a wildlifer, the stake in the forest is about the animal component, and somebody will be an industrial player who is a timber contractor who have a stake in the tree component. Maybe as a regulator, Forestry Commission, my interest is to regulate. That is my stake. And coming together, we can formulate a policy around the resource. That is, we will not be biased in taking decision by always saying good things about the tree component alone, eliminating the animal component. But because putting all of them together makes the forest, so that we make appropriate decisions on the utilization and management of the resource. These are some examples and functions of some few stakeholders. People near the forest are dependent on the forest and always seek that the forest live to perpetuity. They always go in and get something out of it so that they can sustain their livelihood. Forestry Commission, they are mandated to manage and protect the forest, so that without the forest, I have no work to do, because that is my expertise. So that is my stake. Do you understand what I'm saying? Good. Then the industrialists also go in for business. You go in to take something, either for tourism, for timber marketing, for environmental issues, or for climate issues. Then we talk about an activist who can be an NGO. Now, the whole Ghana, everybody can be an activist. So that is an interest. We advocate for proper governance and benefit sharing of the resource. We now come into some major causes of deforestation and biodiversity loss. The current trend in population increase, economic development, social and environmental issues in the country, coupled with international conventions and treaties, has necessitated in the formulation of 2012 Forest and Wildlife Policy. This current trend negatively affects the extent and integrity of the permanent forest estate. Composition, that is diverse species of plants and animals. The structure, that is the stratification of the forest, undergrowth, saplings, emergent trees, canopy formation, that is the various stratification of a forest. All this composition and structure that was found in the early or late 90s are not the same as today. Today, our forest seems to be heterogeneous. We don't have that indigenous stratification of the forest anymore, because they are all planted at the same time. They have been deforested, and now we are now restoring the integrity of the forest. So, please, let's go. The quest for mankind to satisfy basic human needs and aspiration, lack of employment for the growing youth, scarce natural resources, and high demand for forest resources has caused a lot of deforestation. Noticeable among them are improper agricultural practices such as the slash and burn method of farming. That is our local setting. That's how we do our farming. Urbanization, that's opening up of the vegetation for construction and infrastructure development. And technology and industrialization has drastically reduced the quantities, that is the stocking levels, and the quality, the various diversities. If previously in the forest, you go there, you have, especially, I'm going into our local dialect because of the species, their name. They are quite scientific. You have odum, mahogany, shedia, wawa, all these species will be found in a unit of forest reserve. But now you go there and you can find about a single or two species alone, meaning the level of diversity have reduced because of the pressures that have been put on the resource. These are the drivers of deforestation: illegal mining, illegal logging, illegal farming and encroachment of admitted farms, chainsawing, hunting or poaching, wildlife. These are drivers. And during question time, we can interact for further explanation of these terminologies. In the western region of Ghana, deforestation and biodiversity loss has been driven mainly by illegal mining, illegal farming, and chainsawing. These are mitigation measures. To mitigate the effect of deforestation and biodiversity loss, the following effort has been made to restore the extent of damage and integrity of the forest estate by way of plantation establishments through various models by the Forestry Commission. This includes, we have hippie plantation. These terminologies can also be explained during interaction, because if I have to dilate on each, it will take a lot of time during the presentation. Hippie plantation, Greening Ghana program model, which has been extensively dealt with this year. I hope you heard of it, Greening Ghana Day. Yeah, then we have youth in afforestation program. Into brackets, Youth Employment Agency have a model, Youth in Agri and Forestry. That is YEA. The YEA is Youth Employment Agency's model in youth in agriculture and afforestation. Then you have private plantation development, modified tonja system, enrichment planting, FIP, that is Forest Inventory Project. Within that project, we have climate smart cocoa, tree song farm, woodlot, etc. They are a lot more. And we have model plantation establishments that are being undertaken within localities for people to go and see how plantation is being undertaken for you to learn from it. We also have sustainable forest management systems. That is the indigenous or the natural forest, how it's being managed. People have various stakes. So they can go in to remove the timber. Resources are for development. So we cannot say we are protecting the resources entirely without people utilizing them. Then it will be of no use. So we have timber contractors who go in and remove. But they were over-removing or over-exploiting. And it wasn't sustainable. Some time back, you go to European market and timber is flouted in the market. They don't have good value because of exploitation. So we put a quota on the exploitation. Every year, 1 million cubic meters of timber will be removed. Anything over will not be exported to the European market. But that is where the contractors were having their hard currency, dollars. So there was a quota system that will make sure you don't over-exploit. You also have yield allocation. If we are talking about yield, when you plant mango, and you are a mango farmer, at the end of the year, you only remove the fruit and the mango will still be there. That is what we call the yield. So in a forest environment, we have scientifically studied the tree and find out that in every 40 years, those who were saplings or in their youthful stage will get matured into their merchantable or old age. So we go into a unit which is a compartment. We call a compartment, that is a unit of management in every forest reserve. And it has an area of 128 hectares. Within that unit, when somebody wants to do exploitation, we cut straight lines, enumerate 100% stock, and come out with a formula to select our yield. And in every hectare of land, 100 by 100, we select at most 6 trees. 100 by 100, like your school field, if it is a standard school field, 100 by 100 meters. We select only 6 trees. So if we enumerate about 600 trees, we only remove about 60. If you enumerate about 6,000 trees, you take about 650. And each you have a number written inscribed on it. So you go in, and that is what you have been given to remove. When you remove that quantity, in 40 years, you go there and you can remove another yield from the same compartment again. So that is how we sustainably manage the forest reserve. And forest reserves are not wholly harvested. We have portions under different categories. We have protection, we have production, we have convalescence, we have plantation. So degraded areas are put under plantation. And places that are on hills, sanctuary, or close to rivers are protected. We don't remove them at all. So it's not every tree inside the forest reserve will be removed. And during removal, we select trees that have diameter, that are bigger diameters, and those that are about to die. You can see from their leaves, they are dying. And those that have been uprooted by rainstorm, those are the ones that will be selected for the contractor to remove, so that healthy and youthful ones will be left for the next harvesting. We do monitoring of harvesting operations. We go in there, and each tree a contractor fell need to be inscribed by the contractor's property mark, a unique identity, to show that you are the person that fell that tree. Otherwise, when we follow it up to do harvest checks, and we don't find your unique identity and you are the person working there, you will be billed 1,000 times the value. Enforcement of law and prosecution. We have put in place strategies. We have now rapid response team that move swiftly to crime scene to arrest. We have police and military that have formed a monitoring team going around monitoring to find illegal produced timber. And we have trained forest prosecutors ourselves. So prosecution are most of the time done by Forest Commission themselves. And we have a legal unit that assists in prosecution of perpetrators of forest offense. We have this law that was revised and came out in 2017. And it has punitive measures. Very punitive measures that will deter potential offenders. That is revision of legislation. Because before, our laws were 1960s, 1970s, and they were not punitive enough. So this is the current LI regulation that have a lot of punitive measures. We have SRA, that is social responsibility. Contractors who goes to remove have to undertake or enter into an agreement with the French community so that they are obliged to do certain things. respect for other land users. So if I'm a contractor and you are having a cocoa farm adjacent to your the forest, I'm not bound to destroy a cocoa farm because I'm a contractor. I have bulldozers, I have excavators, heavy equipment machines. No, you are bound to respect my land use and my interest. You're also bound to respect the culture, the norms, and the festival of the people. And you are also bound to respect the people within the community. That is the social obligation. And you also have to pay your quota. At least 5% of the royalties is given to the community for their community development from the removal of the resource. We also undertake stakeholder engagement. Very broad now, because our policy emphasizes on closer collaboration with our stakeholders. So when we are drafting a management plan that will assist us in managing a specific forest reserve, we do a lot of consultation. We have a lot of consultation, broad consultation, so that it will be a living document for everybody to have interest in it, because you have your input in that document. So we have a lot of consultation when we are sharing our benefits. We also consult a lot of stakeholders, including landowners and opinion leaders, in how to share benefits. And governance, decision making, they are part of decision making, because every year you have to go and account to a stool landowner how you have managed his resource on his behalf. We also have community education and sensitization. It is part of our annual action plan that every year we have to go to the community and meet them. They will give us information about what is going on inside the forest reserve, because my office in Takoradi, the forest reserve is at Dabwase. So if I don't go to them, there are certain things they know and I might not know, or they see and I might not see. So we go there and interact with them. We are now shifting from the use of analog paper to digitization. Now, when we are doing enumeration, you go inside the forest reserve with a handheld device, for which every enumeration you do, the details will be input live. It's real time. So that from default, it will be transported to the main server at the office.
So we are going to be discussing environmental conservation today. This is the objective of the presentation. I want you guys to have knowledge on what waste management is, who exactly EPA is, and what we do, and then some of the importance of environmental conservation. Preservation is, you have it, you don't use it, then you keep it. You don't touch it at all. That's like having sacred groves. Have you ever heard of sacred groves before? You watch Nigerian movies, right? Okay, calm down. But you've heard of something called evil forest.
Yes.
Yeah, that's just a form of preserving that forest. So they say, oh, evil forest, when you go there, something will happen. Just to prevent human beings from going in there to deplete it. So that's preservation. And then protection. That's you, like, you're hiding it. You're protecting it from depletion. You are keeping it so that nobody, like, harms it. That's protection. Restoration. It's already spoiled. And you're trying to get it back to how it was. Like how you braid your hair is messy, then you go and get it done again. You go and restore it. You understand me? Okay, let's go on. Why do we have to conserve the environment? Does anybody have any idea why we should protect the environment?
Because the environment is always alive.
Okay. Okay.
The environment depends where if we're going to become healthy, more healthy, or probably safer.
Okay. This is solid waste. That's hazardous waste. And this is liquid waste.
My name is Khadija, and then the They said they understand, but I don't understand what it means.
Segregation.
I don't know
what it means.
Oh, okay. So waste segregation is you separating your waste. Are you with me? Separating your waste. So having plastics in one bin, having paper waste in one bin, and then having your general waste, as in food waste and all that, in one bin. So it makes recycling easier. Are you okay?
So now we've all given our opinions on what the term means. So let's see what the internet tells us. So environmental conservation is the practice of us humans saving the environment from the loss of species and the destruction of the ecosystem, mainly due to pollution and human activities. So some of the things that we do, as we said, pollution, human activities such as excessive use of water, excessive use of electricity, all these activities are affecting our ecosystem, which comprises of us humans, plants, animals, and environmental conservation is here to limit our use of all these resources in order to save our earth. Okay, so we are going to look at the importance of environmental conservation. But before I state what I have, I want to see if any of you have anything in mind. Yes.
Okay, Munaj.
The importance of environmental conservation is to save resources for future use, such as the new generation that is coming in today, they will need resources in order to live on our planet. And since we are not the only beings living on our planet, we should try to make it a place where all the creatures will be able to live sustainably.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
The importance of environmental conservation is that when we conserve our trees and things like that, we have some for the future. Like what the lady that came here said, she said that when we finish our meeting today, we'll see the progress later. So it's important to conserve the environment.
Last one. On the back. Okay. On the back. Nana.
It helps to promote biodiversity.
Thank you. Okay, so now let's look at some of the importance of biodiversity. So environmental conservation has an impact in every aspect of life. So the first part, we're going to look at agriculture. When we say agriculture, we're basically talking about farming, our plants, our crops, and all those food, how we get ourselves our food.
So agriculture relies on the environment, so do we rely on agriculture. So agriculture relies on what we do, and we also rely on agriculture because that's the only way we can get our food.
No. Conserving the environment, with regards to agriculture, could mean preventing soil erosion and flooding. Soil erosion means driving the soil away. Erosion basically means breaking down or taking something away from where it was. And flooding is basically when water piles up in a certain area and causes all sorts of hazardous problems to us. Another aspect of our lives are fishing. We know what fishes are. They are one of the sources of food or nutrients. And we also heard of what fishes comprise of, all the various nutrients they comprise of, like proteins and fats. And the only way we can get those nutrients is if these fishes are safe and healthy. And how can we keep them healthy?
It's by means of marine conservation. When we say marine, we are talking about any water body. So protecting our water bodies from oils that are being driven into the water from industries. Because if oil is in the water, it's blocking oxygen from being absorbed into the water so the fishes can also take in oxygen for survival. So if we are masking the water bodies with oil, we are suffocating the fishes, hence making them unhealthy, and we also don't get something to eat. Climate change, we've heard of climate change many, many times, but what exactly is climate change? When we say climate, we are basically talking about the weather. So when the weather...
Protected areas. So to first start listening, you need to know what protected areas are. So what are protected areas? Only one answer.
It's a place that is kept safe, a place where it's kept safe. A protected area is a place which is secured by the government or an important group.
Okay. So you all have a brief idea of what protected areas are. Okay, so next slide. So protected areas are areas which receive protection because of their natural, ecological, or cultural values. It is used as a way to protect some of the very little things we have left on Earth. Next slide. Why are protected areas important? So these are the reasons why protected areas are important. And one is, it safeguards biodiversity. By protecting areas, all the animals around us are safe and can live a very peaceful life. Because there's no hunting and farming and mining and all those things around them. The next is ecosystem balance and preserving important habitats. By protected areas, all the animals can have a very safe place because no human being will be distracting their ecosystem. And their habitat and where they live is all safe and secure. The next is building resilience to climate change and providing global food security. As we all know, trees help in climate change because they store huge amounts of carbon dioxide, greenhouse gases, yes. And maintaining water quality and conserving natural resources. Because there's no mining and because there's no mining and all those things there's water is not dirty. Driving economic success. Yes, by planting trees and protecting some areas, we are able to save resources which can then be used in the future for money and also tourism. Benefits of protected areas. These are what we gain for them. So safeguard biodiversity. By doing this, we can have a peaceful environment because no lion or cheetah will be around here harming us. Prevent spread of diseases. if the animals are kept in a place away from us and there's a disease between them, the managers of the protected areas can stop it quickly before it comes to us. Provide local economic success. Local economic success. Maybe in the village, the people around the natural reserves can get food or food or plants from the trees in the protected area around them. It ensures food and water security, and I've already said it, and builds resilience to climate change. Types of protected areas. So there are strict nature reserves, wilderness areas, national parks, natural monuments or features, habitat species management areas, protected landscape or seascape. The seascape is something like the Great Barrier Reef. Management of protected area. Protected area managers. Protected area managers do some things to prevent them from collapsing or people going there to harm all the species and plants there. So there's something like species management where they record all the animals there and see their impact on the ecosystem. Anti-poaching patrol, where they dispatch forest guards to catch people trying to eat or kill their animals. Providing visitor service, dealing with emergencies by maybe fire. The managers there try as much as possible to stop the fire. Research and monitoring, restoration work, and government policies to help them get some legal support from the whole country. Examples of protected areas. So these are pictures. This is the Wulong National Nature Reserve in China. Panda bears are kept here. The State Park in USA.
Oh, beautiful.
No human being is here, so free, beautiful. Kruger National Park is in South Africa. There are buffaloes, lions, crocodiles, everything there. Bwindi Impenetrable Forest is in Uganda. They protect the chimpanzees and baboons and the rest there from hunting and the rest. Marine National Park, Gulf of Kutch. Kibale National Park is in Uganda. The Great Barrier Reef is in Australia. Nini Suhien National Park, which is in Ghana. Kababu National Park, also in Ghana. Yellowstone National Park in USA. National Park of Upper Niger in Niger. Thank you.
Welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing Esses. What's your name?
My name is Jeremiah Jumambuat Interior.
What class are you in?
I'm in year 8.
All right, so there are many problems facing the environment. Can you name one of them?
I can name deforestation.
And why do you say so?
Because deforestation is the main problem we have, because nowadays factories are bringing up carbon dioxide, and plus we are cutting down trees, which makes it harder for human beings to breathe, which results in dying of people.
All right, thank you. That's very good. But how can you deal with this?
We can enforce strict laws about cutting down trees. That, for instance, if you cut down like 2 trees a day, you have to plant 4 more to help us be able to get more oxygen to breathe in and to save our environment more.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So you're welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing Esses. What's your name?
My name is Jeffrey Asuma.
What class are you in?
Year 8.
That's good. So there are many problems facing the environment. Can you name one?
Climate change.
Climate change, okay. And why do you say so?
This is because climate change has changed the weather patterns of most countries in the world, and it's making it difficult for human beings and animals to survive.
All right, can you tell me how you can deal with this?
We can plant more trees in order to take up more carbon dioxide in which we breathe in, and also plant trees that grow faster in the space of maybe 2 weeks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You're welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing Esses. What's your name?
Akosia.
Many problems facing the environment. Can you name one?
Yes, global warming.
Global warming. And why do you say so?
Because now our temperatures are really getting worse by the day, because sometimes it's over the top. Now we have to protect our environment so we can have our temperatures back.
Very good. So can you tell me how we can deal with this?
We can avoid the use of harmful gases or product burning to release energy and plant more trees.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Hi, you're welcome to this interview. What's
Thank
your name?
You.
My name is Mailing Esses. Sorry, what's your name?
My name is Trinity Tenhor.
What class are you in?
Year 8.
Good. So there are many problems facing the environment. Can you name one of them?
Deforestation.
Deforestation. Why do you say so?
I say so because in my country, Holland, we really do a lot of conservation. And with these conservations, I check I'm from 2 countries, Nigeria and Holland, and there's a huge difference, because when we're in Nigeria, we see the pollution, and all the trees are not being conserved. All the trees are not being conserved, and the gutters are overflowing. But when I go to Holland, I see huge conservation and a lot of growing trees. So every time they cut down a tree, they grow like 2 more.
Okay, that's very good. So do you have any way we can deal with this?
We can by planting more trees. And not only that, we also have people to help out and pick the garbage from the pollution and bring flyers and everything, so they people in Nigeria also can know that they shouldn't pollute too much, because we need some conservation and less deforestation for our future generations.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hi, you're welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing Esses. What's your name?
My name is Mary Noelle Anthony.
What class are you in?
Year 8.
Okay, so there are many problems facing the environment. Can you name one of them?
Deforestation.
Deforestation, okay. So why did you say deforestation?
Because as you can see, us humans were not only breathing oxygen, but we're also breathing toxic gases. And we breathe out carbon dioxide, and we need more of the plants so that they can take in the carbon dioxide. But as we cut down trees, we reduce the amount of oxygen we can breathe in. And
okay,
as people reproduce and reproduce, then we have more population and more people need
more oxygen. All right, so can you help us with a way to deal with this deforestation?
We could bring up laws to punish the people who decide to cut down trees at an unreasonable amount.
You're welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing Esses. What's your name?
Kopias Mini.
What class are you in?
Year 9.
Okay, so can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
Mine is the Yellowstone National Park. It's found in USA.
That's great. Why is it your favorite place?
Because that's the only place where animals there could live freely without being hunted.
great. So why do you think we should protect that place?
So in the 1930s, when there were no wolves, there, the deer and the rest were eating all the plants there. So it made them come dry and made other animals suffer to live there. But they introduced new animals to help the ecosystem.
Okay, and that's why you think it should be protected?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Too sexy for this.
Hi, welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing SS. What's your name?
Noor Kabara.
Good. What class are you in?
Year 9.
Okay, so can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
Zion National Park, which is found in Utah, in USA.
Nice. So why is it your favorite place?
The reason why it's my favorite place is because it has high plateaus, it has a maze made of sandstone, and it has waterfall with colorful hanging gardens.
Great. So why do you think we should protect this place?
The reason why I suggest we should protect that place is because it helps. The reason why I think we should protect that place is because it helps. It prevents animals from becoming extinct, and then they give animals the necessary food that they need to eat and survive. Thank you.
So, can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
The Kanjang Forest in Indonesia.
And why is that your favorite place?
Because it is home to some of the most curious animals in the world, such as the clouded leopards and civets and wild bantang and many other species.
That's great. So can you give me a reason why you think we should protect this place?
Well, this place is at risk of illegal poaching, unlicensed mining and deforestation.
Alright, so why should we protect it?
Because we are at risk of losing the species of animals on this earth, and also some of the wild and interesting plants and animals.
Thank you. Right. So can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
Alpine Lakes Wilderness.
Great. So why is that your favorite place?
Because it's important to the animals living there, like black bears, cougars, elks, and white-tailed deers.
Okay, that's great. So can you give me a reason why you think we should protect this place?
Because chemicals were being dumped there, and the environment wasn't safe for the animals living there.
All right, thank you very much. Hi, welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing SS. What's your name?
My name is Joan Catherine Anthony.
What class are you in?
Year 9.
All right, so can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
Daisetsuza National Park.
Great. So why is that your favorite place?
Because it has a lot of rare species of animals, and they stand for what is right.
Good. Okay, so can you give me a reason why you think we should protect this place? Look in the camera.
Because it's the only place that has the northern pika, which is a small animal, and it also has a large population of brown bears.
Great. Thank you very much. Yeah, welcome to this interview. My name is Mailing SS. What's your name?
My name is Halilal.
Halilal what?
Thank you.
What class are you in?
Year 9.
You're in year 9. Great. Okay, so can you name one of your favorite places of nature?
The Angkasa Conservational Area.
Great. Okay, so why is this your favorite place?
This is my favorite place because it has over 800 species of vascular plant types. It has over 190 different species of butterflies, and also has 190 species of birds.
Great. So can you give me a reason as to why we should protect this place?
Because there are lots of different types of wildlife living there, and it would be a shame for them to go.
Yes. Thank you very much. Hi, my name is Mailing SS. You're welcome to this interview. What's your name?
Thank you. My name is Ajwa Sarpanpong.
What class are you in?
Year 10.
Great. So there are many problems facing the environment right now. Can you name one of them?
Yes, I think one is pollution.
Pollution. All right, so why do you say so?
Because when we pollute the environment, we are sort of causing our air to be toxic. So if we are breathing in toxic air, we are harming our system. If you're breathing in toxic air, we are harming our system. So.
All right, great. So could you give us a way we can help to deal with this problem?
I think we should reduce the amount of toxic gases we release into the environment, especially with our cars and in the industries.
All right, good. So another question I have for you. What's your favorite place of nature?
Place of nature? I think that would be Ebrie Botanical Gardens.
All right, great. So why is it your favorite place?
Because I love how they've been able to conserve all this for so many years, and the attraction is just beautiful.
Great. So can you tell me why you think we should protect this place?
Because it represents our green earth. It also gives us hope as to the fact that we can still save our earth.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being with us today for this interview and for all of you watching.